Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. My special guest today is Julia Burkstaller from the ARC of Minnesota Public Policy Staff. She's going to talk about all the legislative affairs that went on in 2021 and the end of 2020, and some of the great things that the ARC did at the legislative session that they monitored, and some of the things that didn't work that they're going to carry over to the 2022 legislative session, so that'll be coming up. And then we have a very special interview that many of you are familiar with, the name Sue Abderholden, who's executive director of NAMI. She's put together a very special interview on the American with Disabilities Act, and we'll show that coming up in a few minutes. So all that and more coming up today next on Disability Viewpoints. Stay tuned. Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. My special guest today is Julia Burkstaller from Minnesota ARC Public Policy Staff. Welcome to the show, Julia.
Thanks, Mark. Thanks for having me.
Good to have you. Provide us a little background information about yourself and your position at the ARC of Minnesota, and why public policy is so important to this disabled community.
Definitely. So my background is actually in social work. I have my bachelor's degree in social work. I practiced social work for about 5 years as a case manager, independent living skills worker. But my passion was always in advocacy and more of a macro practice social work focus. So I went to graduate school for social work and public policy. Got involved in public policy through an internship with the Minnesota Social Service Association. Then I worked as a coordinator for the This Is Medicaid Coalition as I finished up grad school. And then most recently, I was the advocacy and development manager at Girl Scouts River Valleys, working in their advocacy department. But that kind of brings me to your second question about why public policy is important to the ARC and people who have disabilities. It's really central to the ARC's mission, and you know, promoting and protecting the human rights of people with intellectual and developmental disabilities. Public policy is just a large scale change that impacts the lives of people who have disabilities on many facets, all aspects of their lives, whether it's just civil rights, human rights, services and supports, building true belonging in communities. It really is just the core of the work that we do. And I'd say it's important for people who have disabilities to be involved in every step of the way. And that's something that I really appreciate about the ARC Minnesota, is their commitment for social change, but having people with lived experience at the forefront, centered around all of the work that we're doing in every aspect of the policymaking process.
Now, tell us about the legislation that the ARC of Minnesota was really following, and the impact that you felt it had on people with disabilities here in Minnesota.
Absolutely. So our public policy goals that we were following actually all passed this year, which, you know, I keep saying it's kind of a high bar for me, being my first year to have them all pass, but also just truly incredible. And a lot of thanks to our, you know, self-advocates and partners and allies in the legislature, as well as, you know, community and different organizational partners. But for example, one of our main public policy goals this year was inclusive childcare. So that creates a pilot project with grant funds to help connect children who have disabilities with inclusive childcare in their communities. Another goal of ours was a recovery education bill. So this supports students who have disabilities to recover lost learning during the COVID-19 pandemic. As you can imagine, distance learning, especially for students in special education, a lot of learning loss. So this makes it so those IEP, individualized education program meetings, take place so that they can
that is
that
such
extra
an important
support
thing
they may need.
Yeah, the IEP is still an important thing. It's been around a long time, but it's still an important thing. Tell us about the legislation that did not pass this session and that ARC hopes to follow and pass in 2022 when we come back the end of, I believe it's the end of January 2022. Now, there's a, let's not say that ARC dropped the ball. There's a lot of reasons that it didn't get a chance to pass. We had some protesting going on. We had other things going on in the Twin Cities or in the state of Minnesota. So there's a varying number of reasons why they weren't able to pass the legislation. And if you want to get into why you think it might not have passed, but first of all, if you want to start out with the stuff that didn't pass that ARC will bring back in 2022.
So in 2022, I mean, fortunately enough, our main goals this last year did all pass. So, but there's always room for more. There's always room for growth and improvement, and we're always looking to fine-tune anything. You know, as legislation goes, sometimes you pass it one way and there needs to be more of a support or boost around it. So something I anticipate maybe is that recovery education bill that I did speak about. We do plan to hold community conversations with families to find out how things are going, if they are getting the support that they need to recover that lost learning from the pandemic. So that might be something that we need to bolster again coming into this next session. Additionally, there are more federal dollars from the American Rescue Plan for the state of Minnesota to spend. So the agreement that leadership reached at the end of regular session included $1.2 billion that still needs to be spent. So there's opportunity there for us to make sure that we are passing some transformational policy using those dollars in the most innovative ways possible.
How do you think those dollars will be spent? Do you have any rough idea?
Well, as far as how they were spent this last time and maybe what we could expand on, it would be something around similar to our informed choice legislation, our systems transformation bill, trying to make sure that people who have disabilities who access services are aware of all of their options. They're aware of all of the possibilities of services and are then able to make that choice for themselves and for their families. So, for instance, one thing that passed was a training involving informed choice for case managers, developing that training, the waiver reimagine work that's coming down. It's, you know, ongoing process. It's going to be years of work and implementation guidance needs to be given to the department, to DHS, and making sure that stakeholder engagement is important. So, for instance, some of those federal dollars were used to establish a stakeholder engagement group on Waiver Reimagine, making sure that they're hearing from people with lived experience and families and how that may impact them in their lives. Additionally, there was the task force that was established to phase out sub-minimum wage. That was one of the uses of the federal dollars, as well as grants for different businesses and you know, organizations to help them with that transition to integrative competitive employment. That was one other use. And there are several other ways that they really spent that money in smart ways. And we would hope for them to take this opportunity. It's really a once in a lifetime kind of opportunity with these funds coming down from the feds that we can make some grand systems change to really, you know, better the lives of people who have disabilities and make it so that they are, you know, building a sense of true belonging in their community.
With the pandemic that we are just going through now in the Twin Cities and the state of Minnesota, tell us about how and what ARC did to provide comments and information. Because we know it was hard. We had Community Tuesdays down at the Capitol in St. Paul, but it was very difficult. And when we testified, we had to Zoom a lot. And even that is difficult other than being in person. Tell us what ARC had to do and some of the new ways it handled the pandemic, if you will.
I know, absolutely. I think, honestly, some of the way the pandemic happened is obviously a double-edged sword. So it made things more accessible in ways that they never were or that we did beyond what we could have imagined. But it also was just from a lobbying perspective, it was just a different way of lobbying rather than, you know, you feel a little bit disconnected, you know, not being able to run into a legislator after a committee meeting or run into them in the hallway or just go to their office and try to catch them. But at the same time, it made it so that legislators had to actively reach out to us more. So, you know, we would maybe get more emails of legislators actively reaching out for input or feedback or, you know, questions or concerns about things. And then for those that have access to broadband, you know, greater Minnesota, not everyone has that enough high-speed internet. But for those, I mean, it was more accessible for them. For instance, our Disability Advocacy Day off the Hill is what we called it. Self-advocates from across the state, they were able to attend. We had more than 265 people participate in the event, but then it also live stream reached more than 3,500 people.
Right.
So we were able to reach a lot of people. And then on that same day, we were able to have people testify in the transportation committee on, you know, different access to transportation, whether experience is positive or negative.
Also, what that meant is there was no more rallying at the Capitol or on the front lawn of the Capitol. And that was something that people were used to. And there were different subjects that were attended more often than some others, but it was still an avenue. But the technology, even though you don't see it right away, brings up more of an attendance sometimes. And so this is a new avenue for everybody. Is there any, as we come closer to the 2022 session, we've got a few months yet, is there anything you would recommend to people who are just getting into lobbying that want to help, you know, ARC or any great organization we have out there?
I would definitely suggest subscribing to our newsletter. It's a bi-weekly newsletter. It's called The Capital Connector. That could be found on our website, which is just arcminnesota.org. There's a lot of opportunities, like a lot of save the date events that people can attend. There might be calls to action that come out in that newsletter that people can get involved in. They can always reach out to us at our toll-free number, or they can contact me directly. They can email our info@arcminnesota.org. There's all sorts of options for people to get connected. And we can, you know, depending on what issue maybe they care about, we can get them connected. Another thing that we're doing is we're building congressional district groups, federal congressional district groups called Capital Connectors Teams. We want to have more of a grassroots effort in greater Minnesota, all over the Twin Cities and all of Minnesota.
Kind of a network then.
Yeah. That would be wonderful to have as many people who are interested as possible to be a part of that. And we anticipate, you know, we're still building this program. We anticipate it could be something where they're covering federal issues or state issues. They could be focusing on things specifically in their community, in their congressional district. And, you know, because obviously there are issues that are just different in a greater Minnesota than they are in the metro area.
It's your chance to take the lead, and we'll do a final thought in a minute, but we need a phone number first for local Twin Cities and an 800 number for people statewide, if you would.
So our toll-free number for our office is 833-450-1494. That's again 833-450-1494. And then my direct contact is 952-915-3659. That's 952-915-3659.
We got about 30 seconds left. Can you give me a final thought in case there's something we had missed in this interview?
I just want to emphasize the great opportunity and the great bill, that Health and Human Services bill that passed. We're going to see a lot of innovative change from this bill, and we are not going to lose momentum. We want to see more change in the future. So the ARC is committed to grand system change, really transforming the way that we have been doing policy work, for years. We are in this new era of centering around people with lived experience, and I just truly can't wait to be a part of it.
Well, it sounds good. And Julia Burkstaller, thanks for being a guest on our show today, and we'll be right back with more Disability Viewpoints in just a second. Thanks for being on. In years gone by, and we hope the years ahead, we've had the talents and the knowledge of Sue Abderholden looking over the disabled community, probably at the state capitol and the state office building, who's put in many tireless hours and she is executive director of NAMI. But she has also now put together a great video for the Americans with Disabilities Act, and we'd like to show that to you now on Disability Viewpoints. So sit back, relax, and enjoy it. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Sue Abderholden, and I'm the executive director of NAMI Minnesota, the National Alliance on Mental Illness. And today, what I want to talk about is the impact of COVID-19 on people with disabilities. So honestly, COVID impacted everyone's mental health. It had a huge negative impact. And so I think that's something we need to keep in the forefront. And why was this? Well, first of all, we were living with great uncertainty. When this started back in March of 2020, we all thought it was going to be a month or two. And I think there was this general feeling like, we've got this, right? We can push through 2 months. We can make this work. And of course, by the end of April, beginning of May, we realized this was not a sprint, but this was a marathon. And it was a marathon of unknown miles. And that living with that type of uncertainty is really hard on us. And so people became anxious and frankly depressed because they weren't sure when this would end. The other thing that happened is that people were really worried about catching COVID. And there were, you know, good reasons because we knew the impact that it had. And while people with disabilities were not more vulnerable to catching COVID, it was some of those underlying healthcare conditions that some people with disabilities had that made them more vulnerable to catching COVID and being more negatively impacted. And we saw things like people with schizophrenia were at much higher risk of catching COVID. Partly that was due to obesity, high rates of smoking, heart disease, and lung disease. But we also know that for some people with disabilities, they have those same things, but they might also have a weakened immune system that would make them more vulnerable. The other thing that we saw is that we had people with disabilities maybe who had limited mobility, so they couldn't really avoid coming into close contact with people. They might have direct support providers or family members coming in more frequently into their home, which meant they were placed at greater risk, again, because greater exposure to different people. We also saw that people who were in congregate care settings, whether it was nursing homes or group homes, also were at higher risk, again, because there were, you know, workers coming into their homes, again, creating greater exposure to COVID and then to catching it. And also some people might not be able to understand some of the preventative measures about washing your hands, wearing a mask, those types of things. And for some people with disabilities, wearing the mask also created problems. And then we had people who weren't perhaps able to communicate the symptoms, the beginning symptoms of COVID, so that you could provide that kind of early intervention and support that people needed. We also had many people who were living alone, and so they were isolated, and that was really, really difficult as well. Not being able to see people, not being able to perhaps go to work. For some people with mental illness, going to the clubhouse or the drop-in center, losing those connections, losing their in-person support groups, all of that made it much more difficult for people. We also had people who were, frankly, two together with their families. We're not used to being together with our families 24/7. And so this also added strain to many people's lives because they weren't used to being together all that time. We also had people worried, frankly, about losing their jobs and losing their income. For some people, they also lost their health insurance, which was very problematic. While we certainly have the Affordable Care Act and the exchange, for some people, that also is a very difficult system to get through. And loss of income, you know, during a pandemic, will I get evicted from my home or my apartment? All of that kind of added to the worry and stress of living during COVID. Another thing that happened is something that I would call ambiguous loss. So there was a lot of grief associated with COVID. People postponed or really limited who could attend their weddings. We had people who, you know, were graduating from college, perhaps for the first time in their family, and no one could attend. We had high school students who couldn't celebrate their high school graduations that they've been looking forward to, including the parties. And then we also couldn't do things like grandparents, you know, having the first birthday with a new grandchild. But another part that we don't talk about very much is we couldn't really have funerals as we know them. And funerals are an important part of the grieving process. so that you're with family and friends, that you're talking about the individual who died, that you're telling stories, that you're crying and you're laughing and you're sharing, you know, food with people. All of that is really important, and people didn't get that. And so that ambiguous loss kind of layers over things and made it really difficult for a lot of people. Another thing we saw is, especially for children with disabilities, is that they didn't have access to the services and supports they needed, particularly in schools. So many schools, in terms of distance learning, it was very difficult for those families. We saw, you know, families trying to work and educate their children at the same time through distance learning. Perhaps that child with a disability and in special education had a one-to-one paraprofessional during the day. They didn't get that at home. And so families were sitting there trying to figure out how to help their student. We faced a lot of difficulties in that area, especially. And then we had families who were working and trying to support a loved one who perhaps was elderly or lived with a disability whose workers couldn't come in to help. And so that also, you know, added strain and worry and stress on people. And then I think the other thing is that, you know, some people were able to work from home, but it really wasn't great for a lot of people. They weren't ergonomically set up. They didn't have a huge house so that people could go to different parts of the house to work or to go to school. And so you had many people around a kitchen table, or you didn't have broadband, and that made it difficult too. We also had people, you know, not being able to get the care that they normally did. So perhaps they couldn't get a PCA to come in, right? They couldn't see their physician. They couldn't see their therapist. And telemedicine certainly stepped in, but that didn't work for everyone. We saw children not really able to benefit from therapy over, you know, Zoom. We saw some people not having access to those devices. And so telephonic therapy and support came into play. And while it was workable, certainly in person would have been better. And again, telehealth worked for a lot of people, but it didn't work for everyone. And so we need to really kind of remember that we have people who are struggling because they were not able to access the services and supports that they needed. And many people put off and delayed care because they didn't want to go to the emergency room. They didn't want to go to the doctor's office. They didn't want to be in public transportation in order to get access to their health care. It all just placed them at too great of a risk. And so we are seeing people who delayed care who are really struggling with it. What we know from the CDC reports is that the mental health needs have greatly increased. So we have a whole lot more people, more like 50%, who are experiencing depression and anxiety due to the impact of COVID. We also have seen that more women are struggling than men, and that's partly related to, frankly, the caregiving responsibilities that are often placed on women, especially during this time of teaching children while trying to work. We have younger adults with greater suicidal ideation, and we've also seen a greater rate and an increase rather in psychosis, some of the symptoms related to psychosis. We have really seen an increased use of alcohol and drugs, particularly alcohol. We know alcohol sales have been way up during COVID. You've seen lots of jokes about it on social media, Facebook and Instagram and things like that. And while certainly people use alcohol as a coping mechanism, it's really not helpful, especially if you're already depressed. Alcohol is a depressant, and it just makes you more depressed, not less. And then I would say that the other thing we have found is that people who caught COVID actually have developed depression or anxiety following their recovery about 30 days after. And that's about 34% of the population who caught COVID. So that also is a huge issue. I do want to add that, you know, you kind of add all this strain. And we also had a hard time in the beginning making sure that our personal care attendants, that people working in day treatment and, you know, even in the smaller group homes and things like that, didn't have access to personal protection equipment. They weren't necessarily provided with hazard pay. And that also made it difficult then in finding people who were willing to do this work and to help people and support them to live in the community. The last thing I want to mention is that while we've all been in the same ocean, we have not been in the same boat. So we know that people from the BIPOC community, Black, Indigenous, people of color, caught COVID at a much higher rate because many of them were essential workers. So they were working in nursing homes, they were working in hospitals, they were working in grocery stores, they were working in public transportation. And so they were exposed to many more people. And so they caught COVID at a higher rate. They also were hospitalized at a higher rate and died at a higher rate. And so people from the BIPOC community have been much more impacted by COVID than others. We also know that the murder of George Floyd added a whole nother layer of trauma on people from the BIPOC community. And we also know that the attacks on Asians by blaming them for COVID also created a lot of problems and trauma for people as well, physical and mental. And so as we kind of look to the future and how we're going to address these issues, we just have to remember that not everyone was impacted equally. I do want to say that I have great hope for the future. I think we learned a lot during COVID about how perhaps we can do things differently, especially through telehealth and telemedicine. We also found out how we can connect more with people virtually that maybe we couldn't do in the past. I think we've learned a lot about the importance of human connection, about the importance of, you know, creating routine in our lives as well to battle depression and anxiety. And I'm hoping that people are actually a bit more compassionate in the future because so many people experienced symptoms of depression and anxiety during the past, you know, over a year. And so maybe they'll be more compassionate when people are struggling, frankly, with their mental health. I do think that Minnesotans are resilient. And so I'm hoping that in the future that we'll be able to provide the supports and services needed so that people can kind of recover from COVID, both mentally and physically. And also to remember that just by opening up doesn't mean we're going to cure all the issues out there, that these are issues that are going to be with us for quite some time, particularly among our children who were really impacted by this, weren't able to do some of the social skill development that they needed to. We just have to give people some grace and space in the frankly, days, months, and the year to come. Thank you so much, and I'm really happy to be part of the ADA celebration this year.
That's our show for today. We'd like to thank Julia Burkstaller from the ARC of Minnesota Public Policy staff. She did a great job and had a lot of information for us. And we hope that if we are able to have the public down at the Senate State Office Building and the like next year in 2022, that you'll join her down there and help her with their many lobbying efforts, because they've got some stuff that they're going to carry over from this legislative session that she didn't think worked to the next one. And we'd also like to thank Sue Abderholden, who spent many tireless hours advocating for the disabled at the House, Senate, and State Office Building, and even in Washington, D.C. She's a real gift, that Sue Abderholden, and a real talent. So we hope you've enjoyed that video on the Americans with Disabilities Act, and how important that Americans with Disabilities Act, it affects every one of us. And so we hope you'll have enjoyed this Disability Viewpoints. Stay tuned next time, and I'd like to thank the staff at SPNN for making this all possible, and Jorbers. So thanks for watching Disability Viewpoints. We'll be back, and we'll talk soon. Bye-bye now.